leprosy. God wanted to tell his people, I want to be your doctor through the priest. This is leprosy. People who have these, please don't mix leprosy and this other disease. I don't want to make this a medical lecture, but this is not leprosy. This thing at the side here, many people have that. That's not infectious. That is not a sin. We're talking about the other leprosy that eats and destroys the body. This Hansen's disease, like you see in the insert over there in the left. Important question that we had. Why is leprosy in the minds of people sin? Lee, why? Why is leprosy like sin? And God said, be careful. It is like sin. Sin is like leprosy. You know leprosy? Sin is like it. Number one, we talked about this. It is infectious. يعني بتأدي. Infectious. يعني if you touch, it will go to the other person. Sin is like that. We talked about the bad apple and the 10 good apples. Of course, the one bad apple will destroy and infect the rest of the 10 apples. Number two, leprosy starts small and it starts unnoticed. ما تاخدش بالك. Little spot here, ولا there, ولا on your, you can't see it. Same thing with little sin. You let little sin into your life and it starts to creep inside. And after 10 years, oh, we hear that this family is broken down. Why? What happened? Because we allowed sin to go inside. Number three, just like sin, leprosy is very slow. Spreads. Teta, teta. Just like sin, you can't feel it. You can't. It grows inside your heart little by little without noticing. You start today with some bad friends. Tomorrow you take a draw from their drug, or the day after a pill, the day after 10 pills, the day after we hear that this young man or a young woman was found dead in a hotel room from a drug overdose. Ida, how did this happen? How did it happen? It starts small and it spreads slowly. مشكلة كبيرة هي number four دي. It is painless. Painless. You ask the leper man, are you okay? He says, I'm perfect. No problem. Do you feel any pain? No, I'm perfect. And many of us don't realize the sin inside of us. Samhoni, we don't. We don't see the sin. We feel good about ourselves. We feel okay. Number five, it has no limit. It can go to the young and the old, the man and the woman, the rich and the poor. Leprosy affects anyone, and sin affects anyone, even the leaders in the church side. Number seven, it destroys the nerves. The nerves, you can't feel. You can't, so you put your hand in fire, you touch hot, nothing, you don't feel pain. And so it starts to destroy your body because you can't feel. ونفس الحكاية with sin. Sin makes you spiritually numb. You can't feel that guilt anymore. You can't feel it. When you're so much in sin, you become numb to it. People tell you, yes, sir, what you're doing is wrong. How can you do this? I don't see a problem. It looks fine. It looks okay because I've become numb spiritually. And it destroys the nerves to the eyes and the ears. You become, here's an example, you become spiritually blind. You don't see the importance of going to church. People who had leprosy always lived in isolation. We said the only people in sin will live in isolation at one point in time. And this last point is very important. Shafin, there is no cure for leprosy. غير بمعجزة. And the same thing with sin. You need God to intervene to heal you from your sin. And people knew that leprosy is linked to sin. Shafin, the three inserts there, who is the first one? That was Miriam. Do you remember Miriam and Aaron when they spoke to Moses and he told them, oh, God is angry with you. Miriam became very leper. And we know the story of Jehzi and Elisha when he was greedy and the leprosy that was on King Naaman came on top of him. And last but not least, King Uzziah. I want to tell people here how important the priest's role in the disease of leprosy. Lee, because it shows you the importance of the priest in sin. It shows you the importance that you have to expose yourself in confession in front of the priest. We are now almost December. Have you confessed this year? Aultini? Have you seen your father of confession this year? Maybe I will tell it. Have we contacted our father of confession and made appointment? We have made appointment with the doctor and with the shopping mall and with the car insurance. All appointments are important. But when it comes to the confession, last thing, if you even remember, I'm here to remind myself and remind you. We said three things. You repent before God and confess before the priest. And then you come and take communion. Number one, the priest, when it comes to leprosy, he had to examine the leper man. And if he's not sure, re-examine him again. And if he's not sure, re-examine him a third time and a fourth time until he is sure that that is for sure what he has. Number two, the priest did not cure the patient. All the priest did is he will look at the area of disease and say, oh, this is leprosy, you are unclean. Or when he is cured, the priest will look and say, oh, it seems to be going away. Now you are clean. So the priest only judged. He did not give the treatment. He did not give the medicine. All he said was just say, this person is clean or not clean. If the priest saw someone and the someone showed him, I have a spot here, what do you think? The priest looks and say, oh, I'm not really sure. Go and come back in 1 week. I will examine again. And after 1 week, he is not sure. Go and come back another week. I will examine again. And keeps doing that until he is certain. That shows us that the priests had to be very patient. And God is the same. Habibi, the God is the same with us. He is very patient. He is very, very patient, just like the priest was very, very patient with the people who are sick. And we will always read this particular word, more than skin deep. The problem, if the patch on the skin went deep, this is what made leprosy a leprosy, if you went inside the skin. And look here, the patient, the man who is sick, the leper has no opinion. What does that mean? Yani, leper doesn't go to the priest and say, I am okay, I am clean now. No, no, a leper, his opinion doesn't matter. Whether you think or I think I am good or not important. What is important is how God sees me. Many times I see myself perfect. And I don't want to hear from you telling me I am wrong. I don't like that. Who likes to hear that he was wrong? And that's why the opinion of the man himself was not important.
We bow our hearts, we bend our knees, oh Spirit, come make us humble.
Make us humble.
We turn our eyes from evil things. O Lord, we cast down our idols. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. So give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Not lift our souls to another. O God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face, O God of Jacob.
O God.
the generations that seek, that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees, O Spirit, come make us humble.
Yes, we have to be a generation that seeks the face of God.
And when a priest finds someone with leprosy, this is what happens. This is God saying, it's not Moses, it is not Aaron, it is not Paul, it is not Peter, it is God speaking. He said, anyone with leprosy must wear torn clothes. Number two, let their hair be unkempt, not to cover your hair. Number three, to cover the lower part of your face. Number four, to cry, unclean, unclean, so that people will stay away from you. As long as they have the disease, they remain unclean. We're haram. They must live, eh? Look at this word, live what? Outside the camp. And that's what sin and sinful people are. Sin will make you a lonely person. You may be surrounded by lots of sinful friends like you, but you are alone. And when you talk to people who have come back to Christ, they said that during the time when they're away from the church, they felt alone. Look at these pictures. Number one, God told the leper man, you must tear your clothes. In other words, you must do what? Expose your illness. Expose your weakness. You see, many times we go to our Father of Confession and we sit. Many times we come to church and we are not exposed. We are very tie and a nice shirt. And you look at me, you say, this man, everything better. And I look at myself in the mirror and everything perfect. But it is not. It is not. God is asking me to expose the weakness inside of me. You don't need to expose it in front of me. You expose yourself before who? Before God and before your Father of Confession. Look what the book of Proverbs says. Whoever conceals their sin does not prosper. Okay? Whoever conceals their sin does not prosper, but the one who confesses and renounces them finds wisdom. How is your confession life? How is your repentance life? As we come to the end of 2017, khalas, the few days are left. Let me ask you and remind myself, did you text your Father of Confession? Have you called your Father of Confession to make an appointment? No, we've done appointments with our hairdressers, and we've done appointments with our car people, and we've done appointments with our doctors, and we've booked our check. We've done everything very good. But when it comes to confession, did you put that on the list of things to do? Number two, you must cover your head and cover your mouth. I'm really more interested in this point of covering the mouth. Cover the mouth. Cover the mouth. And don't talk too much. Yani, you are sinful and living in sin. And on top of that, you walk around chit-chatting and talking to people and spreading. Cover your mouth. Today in the discussion part, we spoke about saints of the church. Tell me about a saint of the church who was famous for speaking too much. Zero. They were all popular by being what? Zip. Quiet. Quiet, they would say a word or two. Last but not least, as I said, living outside the camp, just like sinners do. And I showed you this picture where Christ was not afraid to touch a leprous man. Only Christ can heal. Now let us see that a man who had leprosy, God cured him. He came to the pastor or the priest or the rabbi, and the priest looked at him and he found that his illness is getting better, is improving, that the disease is receding, that the symptoms have improved, and that God cured him. What is to happen? Shall he bring him right inside the camp? The Bible says, yes, he can. But first, he has to go through certain rituals. Rituals. And yes, our Orthodox Church is Judeo-Christian. Our roots are from the Hebrew texts, from the Old Testament. All of us are called Judeo-Christians. That means our roots arise from the Old Testament. Chapter 14, and we're left with one chapter, which is 15. Someone who has been cured from leprosy. He's healed already. What happens? God said the following words. If you want to purify this man so he can come again and worship at the temple, so that he can come and offer a sacrifice, so that he can speak with me and he will be heard, the priest has to do these things in front of him. The priest had to bring the man and bring two birds, pigeons. Two, not one, two. And then take one pigeon and slaughter it. Who would do this? The priest! And he will take the pigeon and put it in a flask or a jar with fresh water. You see the pigeon there? It fell inside, right? And of course the water will turn to red because of the blood of the pigeon. And then you had to put inside the flask a piece of wood. Wood? Why? Mushay wood, cedar wood. And then you have to put a piece of green leaf, a hyssop. And last but not least, as you can see up there, you have to put khit, yarn. Luna khit, what is the color? Is? What can you see? Bakra al khodi? Red. So you put inside the flask water, which will then turn to red because of the blood of the pigeon, and you put wood, and you put some scarlet yarn, and you put hyssop. And then, what happens with the other bird? You can see here, you take the other bird, you didn't get that other bird, and you dip it in this water, and then you send it away in the air. Very strange. What is this protocol? What is all this? The Church Fathers teach us that you're looking at Christ. What? This is, I don't see, where is this Christ? God had Christ in mind to purify his people when he said this routine. Number one, why do pigeons? Pigeons are known to be simple. They're very, do you know that when a pigeon's mate dies, they stay loyal to that, shall I say, husband or wife, forever. They don't have any other relationship and they live until they die like that. They are very simple. They are not aggressive birds. They're not like vultures. Or they're not like, they're not aggressive, they're very simple. One of them that is slaughtered resembles this picture on the left, where Christ is slaughtered. Slaughtered on the cross. What about the one that flies free? It is a symbol of Christ, what? Resurrection. And he went up to heaven, free, and he lifted us all with himself. Very, very good. So that's the left picture. Let's look at the right picture. I understand the fresh water. The water is always a symbol of life. It's a symbol of spirit, the Holy Spirit. Whenever you see water in the Bible, it's a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Now why put some blood inside of it of the dead pigeon? Because blood symbolizes the blood of Christ that was poured for us on the cross. Now why wood? The cross of Christ. God knew that there would come a day when Christ will be crucified and killed on a piece of wood. Really? Really? How can you explain? And why the scarlet yarn? Lim chitel ahmar. Why the scarlet yarn? Why? Red. Scarlet is red because, again, the color of blood. And last but not least, why the hyssop? Because this was a symbol of cleanliness at that time. Hyssop, amal bil arab, is a leaf. Hyssop, you know, you wash, you clean dirt from it. And the priest will take this water and sprinkle the man who was healed of his leprosy. How many times? 7 times. And we talked about why 7 times last time. It's amazing when you see this. It opens. This is written in a whole chapter. It is all Christ. All these symbols that you see, they are Christ. If you believe in me, from inside of you, fresh water will run. That's the priest. That's what the priest will do. What about the man who was healed, the leper himself? Well, he too had to do things. Number one, patience. And Isaac tell him about this point for a second. Patience. He was sick, and he had to wait for God to cure him. Waiting on God is a problem in today's generation. You and I have a problem waiting on God to do what is necessary in our lives. We don't like to wait. We want instant gratification. You want the text to be sent right now. You have an app, you touch, you get right now. You go to the machine, you push your credit card, you get the money, right, everything right now. We don't have patience. But the leper, he had to wait, and sometimes he had to wait for months before his illness is resolved. So number one, he had to be patient. Are you patient? Are you patient with the people that live with you? Are you a patient person? Patient. Yani. Are you able to hold off on your wrath and give time? Allow time to work its way. Allow time to work its way. Let's work on God's time and not on our time. His time is always perfect. It may mean it is late for you and me, but according to him, his time is perfect. Number two, the leper man, after he was cured now, the Bible says, God said the leper must go and wash. And it's easy to understand why. Washing means cleansing. Cleansing, cleansing. And that's why at baptism we wash in water. And he had to shave. Just like when you have deacons and they are ordained, you will see that an elder would take a scissors and do what? Yeah, cut their hair. Another symbolization of shaving. Shaving is a symbol of removing the old, getting rid of the what? Old. Shaving is cutting, but in a civilized way. You're cutting, you're removing things. I want to remove the history. I want to remove the sin in my sinful life and start all over again. And then the leper had to go and get some sacrifices. And we spoke about sacrifices in detail. I will just mention them because the Bible tells us explicitly. You had to present a sin offering. We know exactly what that is, and we spoke about it in detail. A guilt offering, a burnt offering, and a grain offering. Shefit. You get a lamb, and a female lamb, and another male lamb, and you get the burnt offering. Who eats of the burnt offering? Nobody. The burnt offering is all burnt. But the sin offering, the priest and his family eats from it, and so does the guilt offering. Thank you. And then you can see he gets an ephah of flour, and puts on it some oil, and offers it as a grain offering. I spoke about this in detail. What I want to say is, after these offerings are made, the priest would take some water, mix it with some of the blood of the sin and guilt offering, and put on it some oil, and mix them together, and anoint the healed man. He would touch him on his lobe of the right ear, on the thumb of his right hand, this one, and on the big toe of his right foot. Do you remember when we said this before? Said about this before when you're anointing a priest. But important, why? Why the ear? Why is it important to anoint the leper man with the blood and the water and the oil on the lobe of the right ear? Why? As if he's telling him, be careful with what has to go here, has to be clean. Clean, haram alayk, clean. Or else you're going to do it again. Clean. It is a reminder for us that we have to hear clean words and clean jokes and clean songs and clean shows and clean stories and clean everything we hear as Christians has to be holy, because this is the book of Leviticus. It talks about the holiness of God. Number two, same thing, anoint the thumb of the right hand. The right hand is reminding me that what the right hand does what? Do. What you do with your right hand has to be good, for the good of God. What you do must be holy. Okay, what are we doing with our hands? What is our hands touching? What is our hands doing? Is it doing things in the light or in the dark? Number three, he had to anoint with the blood, the oil, and the fresh water his right toe, the big toe of the right foot. Why? Reminding him that wherever your foot leads you, you have to go to clean places. Clean places. Clean places. So when you're going place, it has to be a clean place in keeping with the holiness of God. Believe it or not, leprosy is not just a disease of people. Can you believe that even non-living material can have leprosy? You say, I've never heard that before. I said, you have. It's called mildew. You know what mildew is? You don't know, but I can tell you. If you remove one of the tiles, in an old tile in your bathroom, take it out, you will see that underneath it is a lot of what? Green, plaque. It's like plaque. And this is, and it can grow. You know when you have a leaked or a flooded basement, you know when the company comes to clean that, they have to cut all your walls until the walls are dry. Because if you leave the water in your walls, it will start to fungus and grow mildew. And when you come to visit, you will smell a funny smell. It is the smell of mildew. It's that green thing. So it's like sin in a similar way. It starts small and unnoticed, and it spreads. Yeah, and just keep it step back quick, and you cannot get rid of it, just like sin. Here's pictures of mildew. That's why you have to clean the white around the tiles in your bathroom. And when you remove the tiles, it looks like this. Sometimes it eats and rotten carpets. If you leave a wet carpet inside your home, it smells because of the growth of this mildew inside of it. Even if you leave a leather coat or a leather bag, it starts to grow these patches to it. And these are, it's a fungus, and it starts to grow and destroys the object. Now sometimes it also regresses, and the object can revive. But sometimes it grows and destroys what you have, whether it is your clothes and whether it is your home. Is God really interested in all these details? All these details, even the mildew in your shoe? Yes, God is interested in even fine details of my life. He said, if you suspect you have mildew, you have to show it to the priest, whether your home or the object. And the priest will, again, the same words, look, careful examination and re-examination. And he only judges. He cannot cure. He can tell you this object is clean or not clean. If he doesn't know, he is patient. He will wait for 1 week and one other week. Again, he will look and see, is the mildew spreading in your home or not? If it is not spreading in your home, then he will come and visit you a week later. If it continues to recede, then he tells you this home is going to be okay, but we need to purify it. And he will do the same thing. He he will get the fresh water and put the two birds. One bird he will slaughter, the other bird he will dip in the water and let it fly away. And then he will take the water and he will sprinkle the water in the home, and then the home will be pure. So, Ed, when was the last time Abuna came to your home and prayed with you at home and sprinkled water in your home? So important to invite pastors and priests into your home. When did the priest bless your home lately? Take it seriously. When a priest comes to your home, it is a blessing. And he will sprinkle water in every corner. You see, Abuna goes and walks to every corner of every room and every doorpost, and he will sprinkle. If the priest would see that the home is spreading, then it's too late. It is called destructive mildew. It cannot be cured. It cannot be purified. And the man had to burn his home. Burn it. Ihraq. Burn it. Burn it to get rid of the mildew. Okay, Kenny, burn it. Burn it. Have you ever done that? Burn something that has mildew in it? I'm talking about sin. Burn and get rid of it, completely erase it. When you burn something, you remove it completely. No trace, nothing left for your mind to play tricks on you. That's how God wants us to deal with sin. Aggressive. I have to be aggressive. Be aggressive with sin. Not with people around you, not with your family members. Aggressive with yourself and with your sin. And the same thing, sin is spreading in the world today, just like this picture here. And it will be burnt up. Do you know that the world we live in today will be burnt up? The Bible teaches that all the elements will be burned up. And there will be a new heaven and a new earth and a new Jerusalem coming from heaven. Just like what it said. Last slide is chapter 15. Where God dedicates in his Bible a whole chapter for sexual discharge. And there's more sexual talk and sexual problems and how to deal with them next lecture. I want to leave you with a few important concepts written in chapter 15 of Leviticus. Number one, it is very different between a sexual disease that leads to a sexual discharge versus a natural discharge. And they're very different. On the left, you can see that when you have a sexual illness, like today's sexually transmitted diseases, they are infectious. And that's why God said this man or woman, they have to be unclean. Anything they touch becomes unclean. Wanting to be their doctor, to prevent the infection from spreading. And when that man or that woman is healed from their illness, look in red, they must offer a sacrifice, a guilt sacrifice and a sin sacrifice. This is when it comes to illnesses on the left hand. What about natural discharges? As you can see there in green, in males, how about a sexual relationship with the spouse, emission of semen? Or how about when a woman has her regular flow? God said to Moses, in this situation, where a man has an emission of semen with his spouse, he remains unclean until the evening. Unclean means what? Means they cannot offer a sacrifice. They cannot go and worship at the temple until the evening. Or as you can see, if they have an emission of sin, so for a number of hours till the next day. And same thing with a woman who's having her regular period. she becomes impure for 7 days. What happens after the evening? What happens after the 7 days? They're good. Look at the box on the top in green. They don't need to offer a sacrifice. Why? Because marital relationship is sacred in the eyes of God. Whereas someone who has a discharge because of an illness, because of a sexually transmitted disease, on the other hand, it means that something went wrong. They must offer a sin sacrifice. And this is an important difference. After the 7 days or after the evening, they can go. You can see there at the bottom, and this is the last thing I will say, the opinion of the church today in these matters. What does our church say? What does our church say in these matters? Summary of a holy synod studying, dealing with issues related to women receiving Holy Communion. Submitted by who? By the Medical Subcommittee of the Holy Synod. When was this, Shaheen? When was that? Fresh, last year, 2016. The Christian Church clearly states that sin alone defiles a believer. That's a beautiful beginning. And that men and women are temples of the Holy Spirit, which only leaves a person in the case of death in sin. Thus, a woman is a pure dwelling of the place of the Holy Spirit every day of her. However, because of piety and proper care concerning the holy mystery of the church and for the preservation of the traditions, it is fitting for both men and women, Isma Maya, to refrain from communion when you are physically unprepared. Yani, which includes all kinds of bodily secretions, like nocturnal emesis, wet dreams, menstrual cycle, postpartum bleeding, that means bleeding after birth, and normal marital relations. We further assert that any woman in these states is not forbidden, is not forbidden at any time from all spiritual activities, including prayer, no problem, read the Bible, no problem, serving the church, no problem, attending the divine liturgy, no problem. You can reach that. We also emphasize that a child, male or female, can be baptized on any day after his. In summary, these chapters that we have spoken to today talk about the holiness of God. God wants his people to be a holy people. A holy people. If you are to remember one slide of all today's discussion, I want you to remember this particular slide. The slide where you saw the balls of black and the balls of blue. Those are the ones that are important. I think we've spent quite at least 5 or 6 weeks talking about this, but believe me, this is the root of many confounding theological understandings in the New Testament. Whenever you read, you will read that God relates to the Old Testament sacrifices, to the cleansiness and uncleansiness of the Old Testament.